78, song number 78. Higher ground, I'm pressing on.
Thankful that we got something to stand on. Brother Craig, would you open us in prayer tonight, brother? Amen. You may be seated. So thankful that you're here to see me. Some announcements here. Ladies Bible study at on Tuesdays from 9:30 to 10:30. 9:30 to 10:30. Join us for an encouraging time as you study God's Word, ladies. Tuesdays from 9:30 to 10:30. And then this coming Saturday is the Christmas party. Ladies, you're going to the Christmas party. You're attending the evening showing of The White Christmas at the Candlelight Dinner Theater. Please meet at the theater at 6 p.m. or at the church at 5:15 if you want a ride there. That's this coming Saturday, November the 19th. And then the Teen Thanksgiving Service, Tuesday, November the 22nd. And that's just a week from this coming Tuesday. And the teens will be conducting everything. And then Music and Memory, Sunday, November the 27th. Brother Bronner Smith will be here singing the piano. We also will be Brother Smith's last Sunday with us. He and his wife are moving to Missouri and going to be near their son Bronner there and be a blessing there at at their church there, Brother Marshall's church. Sorry, you would think.
What's that?
Riverside Baptist there, Brother Marshall and them, what a blessing there, and those things there. And then the Christmas program, December the 18th at 10:45, we always invite people for that, and that's a great time here. And then the bake sale for the teens is really next Sunday, next Sunday, will be the bake sale. It's already here. Where did it? It's coming. And then that following week from Thursday is Thanksgiving. So it snuck up fast, didn't it? So we kept saying the bake sale. Well, that's next Sunday. So bring your money and be prepared. And then the teens are going to the youth rally this Friday, the 18th. And they're going to Tri-Town and meet at the church at 5:45. And then they got lots of other things there. So make sure you avail yourself to the calendar for the teenager. So glad you're here to see me. Lord bless you.
Psalm number 86, my Jesus, I love thee, 86.
Call me never, 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 never heard this week that if we are drifting in our love, we need to return back to the cross of Calvary. That'll make a difference. Thank you, Miss Melissa. Thank you, Miss Melanie. I appreciate your help. Thank you this evening. You may be seated. Take your Bibles tonight and turn to the book of Proverbs in chapter number 2. The book of Proverbs in chapter number 2. Who would have a testimony tonight? Perhaps something about the revival, perhaps not. Something from this week. All right. Well, we'll just go ahead. Yes, ma'am. Miss Mary. Amen. Answers prayer. Their father's doing much, much better. We rejoice. Someone else? Mrs. Weddle.
Last week of July, I couldn't walk.
Amen. Last week of July, struggling to walk, and now she's walking. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Miss Deanna. Amen. God always does really good in our life. Not just right now, but always is really good in our life. What else? Brother Gabe. Praise the Lord. Miss Ann.
We didn't even know, but God did, and He worked it out to where we got to be there for that show. And I just thought, wow, God, You really do care about us.
Amen. Amen. Simple things. Simple things. Amen. Miss Sarah. Miss June.
A lot of times when I come home late from church or something, I'll accidentally
Amen. Also, if you're looking for a house to rob, Miss June often. Praise the Lord for the little things, for his protections. Miss Faith. He that keepeth Israel will neither slumber nor sleep, the Bible says. Amen. Amen. Wonderful. All right. Proverbs chapter 2 tonight. Proverbs chapter number 2. And we'll begin reading in verse number 1. Proverbs chapter 2 and verse number 1. My son, if thou wilt receive my words and hide my commandments with thee, so that thou incline thine ear unto wisdom and apply thine heart to understanding. Yea, if thou criest after knowledge, and liftest up thy voice for understanding, if thou seekest her as silver, and searchest for her as for hid treasures, then shalt thou understand the fear of the Lord, and find the knowledge of God. For the Lord giveth wisdom, out of his mouth cometh knowledge and understanding. He layeth up sound wisdom for the righteous, he is a buckler to them that walk uprightly. He keepeth the paths of judgment, and preserveth the way of his saints. Then shalt thou understand righteousness, and judgment, and equity, yea, every good path. Our title tonight is this, but what if you are the horse? What if you are the horse? Lord, we have already praised you tonight in song, and then we've praised you tonight in testimony. Lord, may we not exaggerate it, but we've already praised you tonight in obedience just by being here. And so, Lord, we trust that you will feel comfortable, that you would feel honored, that you would feel respect from your kids tonight in your house. Lord, we ask that you would have free reign. We ask, Lord, the text is good. I believe that the way you've orchestrated it to present the text tonight is good. But, Lord, we don't want to, that's insufficient. Lord, it's not insufficient to accomplish what you want, but it's insufficient, Lord, on its own. May we choose tonight to listen. May you choose tonight to convict. May you connect the truth to the heart. And Lord, only you can do that. And Lord, if that's done tonight, you'll be the one who gets the credit for it. I truly believe decisions could be made tonight that would impact generations, that would impact, Lord, especially in the lives of our young people the next 20, 30, 40 years. Lord, we are saddened tonight. We're disappointed. We know there's many that are sick and hurting. We ask, Lord, your comfort upon them. But Lord, there are some who are perhaps even watching online that you'd speak to them. Through the preached word of God tonight, you would do a miracle in their life. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. What if you are the horse? There's no horse in our text. Some of you may have gone home this afternoon and read and been like, there's no horse in chapter 2. I don't know what he's talking about. How many of you have ever heard the expression, you can lead a horse to water, but you... Pretty famous idiom, a pretty famous expression. And basically the meaning, the purpose of the expression would be this, that regardless, we're just going to use Brother Dave tonight as if he was my son or whatnot, that I am leading him. All right, that's tough to imagine, I guess. But anyhow, and so we're going to lead him to some place, and I can lead him to the water, but I cannot make him drink. I said that to my dad one time when I was a young man, and he goes, "Yeah, but I can drown you." And there's, you got to understand my dad to know what he meant by that. So the idiom is that I can lead Brother Dave to the place of truth. I can lead Brother Dave to the place of benefit. I can lead Brother Dave to the place where he has to make a choice, but he has to make the choice. However, the idiom or the saying presupposes something, and that is this. It presupposes that you're the one leading the horse. But can I ask the question tonight, what if you're the horse? You're not the one leading. You're the one that needs to make the decision. You can be brought to the place of water. You can be brought to the place of a decision. You can be brought to the place of truth. But unless you choose to partake, unless you choose to drink, unless you choose to enrich your life, there is nothing that anyone, including God Himself, is going to do to change your heart. You see, tonight in life, much of our life has to do with our own personal choices. Some examples of this tonight would be, in large part, our health. Now, I understand, I'm giving an illustration, and illustrations aren't biblical, so they're never perfect. Okay? Only the Bible is perfect. Don't leave here tonight and say, Pastor said the reason why my hip hurts is my own fault. I didn't say that. I thought it, but I didn't say it. No, tonight, there's no one else that can help my health but me. Brother Jay could eat all the vegetables in the world, and it will never benefit me. Or him. It's not going to happen. My wife is hung up on colors. We go out to eat, and we get stuff, and she goes, you have no color on your plate. Who picks food based on color? We're not painting the kitchen. We're eating a sandwich, okay? It's different. Brother Jay can run every day, and he does, I believe, most days still. He goes running and exercises. And you know what? Him eating healthy and him exercising does me absolutely no good. We understand that. That maybe he would serve as an example. Maybe he would serve as an inspiration. No, not really. I can sleep while he runs. It's not a problem for me at all. But we understand in the area of our health that unless I choose personally to determine what I eat and be cautious and careful and mindful of what I eat, and unless I personally choose to lift weights or go running or exercise in some manner, that the fact that you do it or that others have done it doesn't benefit me at all. Education would be an area where we are personally responsible for where we're at. I didn't say intelligence, I said education. There are some people who are very well educated and still aren't very intelligent. But that's another message for another time. No, tonight I could teach theoretically, I could teach someone to read. But I cannot make them read. I can show them A says ah, like apple. I mean, we could go through all the things, and I could try to instruct them as to how to read, but I cannot make them read. Your parents, to the young people in the room tonight, your parents can lock you in a room and sit you at a desk and make you do your homework, but if you don't want to read, if you don't want to be an active participant, you can stay ignorant if you wish. It is your personal choice. It is your personal choice. Where you stand is your personal choice. There are languages that could be learned. There are languages that could be learned. I feel stupid at times, that I have guilty at times, that would be a better word choice, that I haven't learned Spanish. I need to learn that language. I need to be able to communicate better with the people in the area that God has called me to. You know why I haven't? Because I haven't chosen to do that. It's not society's fault. Right. It's not the public school system's fault, although there's a lot we could blame there. It's not the governor's fault. It's not the senator's fault. It's not the politician's fault. It's not my wife's fault. It's nobody's fault. It's my fault. My education, my knowledge of things, is ultimately my responsibility. Your relationships tonight are ultimately your responsibility. This is silly. Remember when you were a kid, and at some point in time, this is true of every one of us, your mom and or dad, more likely your mom, made you play with someone you didn't want to play with. looking around the room. Some of you are shaking your head, yes. Some of you are like, no, that means you were that kid. I hate to break to you and to do psychological damage at the beginning of the message, but that means that you were that kid. I can remember there was a missionary kid, and her name was Keisha. My sisters are watching this. They would be laughing, and my mom would be laughing because they could remember it. And she caught on that we were only playing with her because my mom and dad made us. And I remember her going, "You don't really want to play with me, do you?" And I knew what I wanted to say, but I also valued my life. I also valued my life. Your parents can't choose your friends for you. You can't. I can't pick your spouse for you. I can watch your marriage. I can see from afar and go, "Oh, I think if he would do this, it would make that better. If she would apply this, it would make that better." And really, I could apply the scriptures, and we'd know it would be better. But me knowing that doesn't really help you.
Right.
In fact, you knowing that doesn't really help you either. You have to choose to do it. And there's no one else that can choose for you. Husbands, no one in the room can make you work on your marriage. Wives, no one in the room can make you be submissive to your husband, can make you take a biblical position in your home and a role in the home. No one can make you do that. No one can invest in friendships for you. I hope to be influential in who my kids marry. I hope to be a filtering process. I'm not so much worried about who they do as I am worried about who they don't. But ultimately, your relationships are your responsibility and your choice. The same thing's true spiritually. Hear me now. We're getting there. I'm not ignoring the text. We're just setting up the text. Same thing's true spiritually. No one can make you choose God. No one can make you obey God. "Oh my, you don't understand my dad. You don't understand." No. They can make you obey them. They can put consequences. But you understand there's coming a day where they won't be able to make you do that. No one can make you love God. Love is a choice.
Right.
No one can make you love God. No one can make you serve God. No one can make you obey God. These are all personal choices. And just like your education, and just like your health, and just like your relationships, they are predicated on the choice and the labor and the effort that you choose to make. Now, there's some danger in not making the choice, or in sort of drifting. Coasting would be maybe the more appropriate word. Church is awesome. No, the local visible body, the assembly of baptized believers who have come together and said we are uniting under one creed, the Word of God. We are uniting under one person, the person of Jesus Christ, and we want to follow Him, and we're going to be different, and we're going to have our distinctions, and we're going to have some differences, but by and large, we're going to come together as a church, and there can be a danger that as Calvary Baptist Temple goes, so you think you're going. But it's possible to be a member of Calvary Baptist Temple, even a faithful member of Calvary Baptist Temple, and to have your relationship with God be far less than what He intends for it to be, or far less than what the church as a whole is. Well, what do you mean? How many of you know who Bill Weddington is? Bill Weddington? He's got 6 NBA championship rings because he played on the same team with Michael Jordan. You don't have to be that good when you're on the same team with Michael Jordan. I'm not equating anyone here to being Michael Jordan, but I'm saying it's possible to drift with the team and to think that you're doing well because the team is doing well, but the reality of it is your walk with God is substantially less than the average member of Calvary Baptist Temple. Perhaps you're not even thinking that broad. You're looking more at your individual home. Well, my home is fine. My home is doing well because we're being obedient. And in large part, we're being obedient because my spouse is obedient. I mean, I would watch that television program, but I know my wife would say something, so I can't watch that television program. Got a little tight on this one already. No, I'm not talking about weird things, okay? Like, my wife hates anything with space. My wife is convinced, not literally, but that space is for nerds and there is no such thing as space. And Star Wars and Star Trek and anything like that, she won't let me watch, won't let my son watch. She goes, why? She goes, I want him to get married someday. And so. So when my wife's out of town, I watch a lot of sci-fi stuff. It's fun. We're not talking about things. We're talking about things where you go, no, that cursing really doesn't bother me, but it bothers my spouse, so I can't because of them, but I would if I could.
That's good, yeah.
And we feel like we're doing okay, and we feel like we're being obedient, and there's no quote-unquote major sins in our life, but it has nothing to do with our personal choice for God, and everything to do with the fact that we're coasting on the coattails of a family member. Maybe tonight that there's all kinds of clothes, all kinds of music, that all clothes you would wear and music that you would listen to were not for the parent in your life. And you're going, well, I'm a good Christian. I don't listen to that. I don't watch that. I don't wear that. I don't participate in that. And all of that is true, but it is also true that you would if you could. Right now, it just so happens that you can't. But there's coming a time you'll be able to. If you're blessed tonight to attend a Christian school or to be homeschooled, well, I don't hang around the wrong people. Well, newsflash, you're homeschooled. Kind of hard to hang around the wrong people. Don't think tonight that because your parents have put you in a protected environment that means you're making wise choices. Maybe tonight that you're drifting in the youth group, coasting in the youth group. You know how to act, you know how to behave, you know what to do so as not to get in trouble and maximize making the best in your mind almost of a worse situation or a bad situation. You're able to coast along with it so that go along to get along, we call it. But none of these things mean that you have a personal walk with God. None of these things mean that you have a personal relationship with God. Our text tonight, and forgive us for talking so much before we get to the text. Our text tonight is about personal responsibility. Let me repeat that. Our text tonight is about personal responsibility. Notice if you would in verse number 1, my son, if thou will receive my words and hide my commandments with thee, so that thou incline thine ear unto wisdom and apply thine heart to understanding. Yea, if thou criest after knowledge and liftest up thy voice for understanding, if thou seekest her as silver and searchest for her as for hid treasures, then shalt thou understand the fear of the Lord and find the knowledge of God. Verse number 9, then shalt thou understand righteousness and judgment and equity, yea, every good path. Solomon is writing to his son again in verse number 1, my son, if thou, but he's saying, my decision to do these things, my decision to follow these things, my choice to have a relationship with this person may be an influence on you, but it is not enough for you. You must choose yourself. Can I remind you tonight? You must choose yourself. On a Sunday night in mid-November, there is a good chance that the vast majority of people in the room are saved, perhaps even most of the people watching. But this would be a good place just to interject and remind us that unless you personally have made a commitment to Jesus Christ, you're not saved. And it doesn't matter what church you're a part of. It doesn't matter what your last name is. It doesn't matter that your grandpa was a preacher. It doesn't matter any of those things. When did you personally choose Christ? You're not saved tonight without a personal choice for Christ. Solomon is begging his son. He's begging his kids. And he uses the term son. He addresses most of the time, chapter 3, verse 1, my son, chapter 4, verse 1, children. Most of the time he addresses it to son. But he's trying to get his kids to serve God. And this is what he says tonight. You have to choose. If you will do this, if you will decide, if you will make this your choice, Elijah, then God will do this. Notice what he implores his kids to do tonight. My son, if thou wilt receive my words. First of all, tonight, if you and I are going to make this personal choice, we have to make the personal choice to accept what the Bible says personally. We have to accept what the Bible says personally. Have you ever, come on, I'm a preacher's kid, so I can preach this and mean it and have illustration for days and days and days. Preach what? Have you ever heard the preacher preach something and you're like, okay, but in your mind you're like, mm-mm. I ain't doing that. I don't believe that. I ain't following that. But you sit there with a dumb look on your face, but we'll be nicer. You sit there with a whatever look on your face, and you're just going, you don't really believe it personally. I can remember years ago going to a preacher's meeting and my dad talking to me about the local church versus the doctrine, the false doctrine of an invisible church, and that what was bound on earth was bound in heaven, what was loosed on earth was loosed in heaven. And I remember him going on and on about it. I just remember staring him at the restaurant going, when will you quit talking? Like I'm not being rebellious, I'm not doing drugs. Isn't that good enough? Come on. I didn't receive the words personally. I didn't get it personally, but you know what? Later on I began to understand, later on I began to see, later on I began to grasp, later on I began to receive. And can I tell you tonight, it is not sufficient that Calvary Baptist Temple be King James. It is not sufficient that we preach salvation by grace through faith. It is not sufficient that we preach holiness and standards. You must receive the words. You have to choose. And there comes a time where being a part of a group who holds a position is insufficient for your personal walk with God. There comes a time when the fact that your mom and dad come to church will be insufficient for you. You must receive the words. Reading on, you must receive my words, if thou wilt receive my words, excuse me, I didn't mean to misquote it there, and hide my commandments with thee. Not only are you to receive the word of God, you're to memorize the word of God. That's what it means to hide the commandments with thee. Hiding the commandments allows you to know the why for the rule. Now, when you're a kid, you just kind of got to know the rule. You want a cigarette? No. Why? Because I don't want my parents to kill me. As you get older, you learn our body is the temple. Come on, we memorize verses such as that. And we're to abstain from all appearance of evil and those kinds of things. And so we begin to put those verses into practice in our lives. When I was a kid, I was cautious in my behavior towards the opposite sex. Why? Because I loved God. No, I was afraid of my dad. Afraid of my dad. But there had to come a time when I began to internalize those convictions and not just live off of his coattails and not just follow his advice and not just follow his counsel, but listen to the word of God, receive the word of God personally, and then hide it, memorize it, put it in my own heart, where Psalm says, thy word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against thee. And so when the internet comes on or the cell phone comes out and the temptation is there to go somewhere or to do something I shouldn't do, then it's not just, I'm afraid my dad will catch me. I'm afraid my wife will catch me. No. It's, I have made a covenant with mine eyes. How then can I look upon a maid? Mine eye affecteth mine heart. No, come on. He that looketh after a woman and lusteth after her hath committed adultery with her in his heart already. You can't memorize scripture because your mom and dad make you. You can't memorize scripture because I make you. And let's be honest, most of us don't memorize scripture. Well, I struggle to memorize. I struggle to memorize. Please. You can tell me everything about John Elway and his draft status and his this, that, and the other thing. You can tell me everything about tuning and timing. I just make up stuff and it sounds stupid, but a 454 engine and the caliber with the 3 in the tree and the 4 on the floor and the 8 in the gate and whatever else. Come on, we memorize what's important to us. Hello, we memorize what's important to us. If thou wilt receive my words, number 2, and hide my commandments with thee, verse number 3, so that thou incline thine ear unto wisdom. Listen. listen. So this illustration has lost a little luster in the last 2 weeks. Our printer, we thought it was fixed. It printed 10 bulletins, and then it died again this morning. So it's, come Black Friday, we're going to get a new printer. We're going to work something out. So you print up the announcements in the bulletin. You hand them out to everyone. They are readily available. The information's on Facebook. The information's on the church app. And there will not be a week that goes by that somebody doesn't text me or call me or text my wife and call my wife and go, what time is the revival meeting? What time are we meeting to go to Texas? What time is the ladies thing on Saturday? Okay, I didn't think that would get tight. I thought that would be a funny illustration. That would be. But we're good at hearing, but not real good at listening. You know how you listen in a, you know how you really get something out of a sermon? You choose to.
Right.
You choose to. You choose to sit up, you choose to ignore, you choose to focus. In my head, I can remember as a kid sitting in church and playing cowboys and Indians and Civil War and in my head, and I would tell stories in my head, and then the next service I'd pick up right where I left off. Like on Sunday mornings, I would do this kind of battles in my head, and Sunday nights, I would play these kinds of games in my head. And some of you are like, that's genius. But I didn't get much out of the service. And it wasn't the preacher's fault, and it wasn't the church's fault, and it wasn't God's fault, and it wasn't the Bible's fault. It was because I didn't choose to listen's fault.
Right.
No, he says, so that thou incline thine ear unto wisdom. You gotta listen to what's taking place. No one can make you listen. No one can make you listen in church. No, we can kind of guilt you about your phone, and we can make you behave reasonably. I mean, we try with Marlo, but I mean, she's not here. I'm sorry. Reading on. And apply thine heart to understanding. No one can make you apply it. Nobody can make you apply it. We can give all the good counsel, all the good advice, all the biblical truth in the world. And can I tell you, everything that pertains to life and godliness is written right here. Now, let me repeat that. That's Bible. Everything that pertains to life and godliness is written right here. Well, how do I conduct myself as a young man? It's written right here. How do I act as a husband? It's written right here. How do I raise my kids? It's written right here. How do I handle my finances? It's written right here. How do I forgive someone? It's written right here. Everything that pertains to life and godliness is written right here. But if we don't apply it, it won't do a hootenanny worth of good. And I don't even know what a hootenanny is. Years ago, I took a CDL physical and I failed it. I failed the vision portion of the test, and so they sent me to, I don't know, an optometrist, an ophthalmologist, I don't know which one of those, they sent me to the eye doctor guy. And so he tested my eyes and he wrote me a prescription. He handed me the prescription and he said, you can go get this filled at wherever you want to get it filled, whatever, da da da. He said, but don't lose this because you need this prescription to get your CDL physical. And I said, you mean I need this paper to get the glasses so I can get the CDL physical? He said, no, you don't actually have to get the glasses. You just have to show them you got the prescription. I don't actually have to get glasses. I just have to have a piece of paper that says I got tested. Yes. Government 101. Don't you feel safer riding in a bus with me? By the way, ladies, also just a reminder, 5:15 on Saturday, I will be driving the bus to the ladies' Christmas program with glasses. All right. Simply having the prescription does me no good.
Right.
You got to fill it. You got to apply it. The Bible warns us in the book of James about being doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving our own selves. Brother Park, I'm King James. I'm King James. Bless God, if this church ever is anything other than King James, I'm out of here so fast. Oh, I'm King James. How much of that King James did you read this week? I mean this with all due respect. I have little to no respect for someone who takes a King James position. Now, let me rephrase that. I'll go ahead and say it right. I have no respect for the person who takes a King James position but won't spend time in the King James. Yeah. It got quiet. Yeah. Got quiet. Brother Park, I mean, you better preach soul winning and evangelism, and you better care, and you, praise the Lord. No, I should, and you should care, and we should be evangelistic and all those things. But I really don't have much respect, nor does it do you much good at all to demand that I do it when you won't. Bless God, I watch your daughters, I watch your son. They wear wrong clothes. If they have wrong attitudes, man, I'm going to hold you. And by the way, hold me accountable, all those things. But can I tell you, that's not really going to help your spirituality, your walk with God one bit. You have to apply the Word of God. Well, you go, Bill Park, is that an excuse for you? No, who's talking anything about an excuse for me? I'm just saying you can point out the flaws in someone else's life, and that's not going to help you one bit in yours. If thou, so that thou incline thine heart unto wisdom and apply thine heart to knowledge. Verse number 3, if thou criest after knowledge and liftest up thy voice for understanding, not only do you have to apply it, you have to put forth some effort. Thou criest after knowledge and liftest up thy voice for understanding. Most things in life take effort. Yes. Amen. Ever gotten one of those little things in the mail? By the way, be careful about this and don't click on emails from Nigerian princes and whatever. That's don't do that. It says, well, you know, you can get this for free. Or one of the things I love to do is I love timeshare presentations. Because I will sit there and just stare at the guy for 90 minutes and get done and be like, okay, give me my free whatever. And I have no guilt in that whatsoever. It drives my wife nuts. But they have this rule that you got to take your wife with you. You can't just go by yourself. If not, that would be my part-time job. I would just go to timeshare presentations and get free stuff. To get something for quote-unquote free, typically there's some hooks. There's some catches. There's some things. Some effort has to be put forth. Can I just tell you the Christian life is the same way?
Right.
Church is boring. It's because you don't put any effort into it.
Right.
Calvary's gotten a little stale. Maybe we have. Maybe you don't put any effort into it.
Come on.
Our song service, man, I love it when it's vibrant and passionate. I don't recall hearing you this morning. Come on, there's some effort that if thou searchest, if thou criest after knowledge and liftest up thy voice for understanding, there's some passionate effort involved. I'm convinced tonight. There's some people, perhaps some young people, in my mind, forgive me, I still think too much like a youth director, that are going, yeah, that's good for my mom and dad. That's good for my mom and dad. But I've tried it and it didn't work out. No, you didn't. You didn't. You didn't. You read your Bible one day. You came to church one time. You invited somebody one time. You paid attention 2 days at camp. And you think you put forth effort. And that effort won't get you anywhere in life that matters, much less spiritually. You give effort for a coach for 2 days and see it's insufficient. Reading on, the next verse. If thou seekest her, silver and searches for her as for hid treasures. There has to be effort, but there also has to be continual effort. Continual effort. I'm not a member of any gym, but imagine if I were. Some of you are shocked to hear I'm not. Most of this is just natural. I just thought I'd share that with you. I walk into the gym, I've got my gloves, I've got my chalk so I can, lift, and got my good shorts and my World's Gym or whatever t-shirt or whatever's popular now. That's like probably 1980s, I don't even know. And that was about the last time I was in a gym, and I've got my shoe. Man, I am decked out, and I walk in, I sign in, I say hi to everybody, and I go over, and I vroom, vroom. See you next week. How much good has that done me? No, I look the part. I can tell my wife I went to the gym. Maybe I'll get a little dessert because I went to the gym. But it didn't really change anything. The Word of God is powerful. If you'll read it tomorrow, it'll do you some good. But if you read it tomorrow and ignore it the rest of the week, the benefit of what you get out of it tomorrow won't keep you going on Friday and Saturday. You can tell temptation no tomorrow, but if you give in to temptation on Tuesday, man, that was too many T's. If you give in to temptation on Wednesday, that was better. The fact that you said no to it on Monday didn't really do you any good.
Yeah. Right.
There has to be a continual effort.
That's right.
Oh, there's a payoff. Oh, there's a payoff. Verse number 5. Then shalt thou understand the fear of the Lord and find, whoa, listen to this, and find the knowledge of God. You, then shalt thou, Liberty Ann Sutton, find the knowledge of God. You will know who God is. I already know who God is. Do you know Him? Or do your parents know Him? Does your spouse know Him? Does your church know Him? Or do you know Him? We got to hurry tonight. Then there's a shift in the text. Verse 5 is the transition. In verse number 6, Solomon says to his kids in verses 1 through 5, if you will do this, then beginning in verse 6, God will do this. This is how God will respond. For the Lord giveth wisdom. God will give you wisdom. Wisdom is the ability to know what to do. Have you ever met people that just somehow, they just know what to do? Like the car breaks down, they know what to do. The kid breaks down, they know what to do. They just know what to do. How do they know what to do? They know God. Hello? They know God. And God always knows what to do. So God goes, because you know me, because you've chosen me, because you've pursued me, because you've memorized Scripture, because you've received it, because you've listened, because you've applied it, I'm going to give you wisdom. I'm going to tell you what to do. And it sure is nice to be told what to do in certain situations. I am already old enough where this is a routinely done thing in our home. I can't figure this out. Will you fix this? Last night, I'm trying to download all the pictures and put them in one file on my phone. I tried for like a half an hour. I handed it to my daughter while she was making the video. Good video, by the way. Great video, by the way. And she's like, oh. It's weird because you want to say thank you and slap them at the same time. I don't know how that works, but it's nice knowing what to do. Our world is changing. It's nice knowing what to do. How are you going to handle a person that's has decided to be something different than what God made them? We're to love them and give them the gospel. What do we do after they get saved and they already have adopted people and have a spouse? And you need wisdom. You need to know God. How can I pick a spouse? You need wisdom. Because that girl that looks great may not be that great. And I assure you, that guy that does is probably just faking it. So I should do it. No, you should do it because you love God. But the benefit of it is that God will give you wisdom. Not only will God give you wisdom, reading on, verse number 6, for the Lord giveth wisdom, out of his mouth cometh knowledge and understanding. Don't you hate it when you're the person in the room that doesn't understand what's going on? Some of you are trying to stare at me real cool, like, what do you mean? Never happens to me. So I appreciate good preaching. I love good preaching. When someone does the work in the Bible and mines the truth out of the Word of God, and they explain something and you go, duh, now I get it. And forever you'll see it that way. I mean, you once you see it, you can't unsee it. It's just, bam, it's there. It's like those little Rorschach tests, you know, the ship that was in the picture that was hidden. It was real popular in the 90s. Remember what I'm talking about? These people have no clue what I'm talking about. I never could see them dumb things. Once you can see it, then you can't unsee it. God says, I'll give you knowledge. I'll give you understanding. Reading on, verse number 7. He layeth up sound wisdom for the righteous. He layeth up sound wisdom for the righteous. He is a buckler to them that walk uprightly. What's a buckler? We would use the term shield. Now the Bible uses the term buckler, so it's a buckler. But we would use the term shield. I was joking with Brother Dave about this morning. Every time I see the word buckler in the Bible, I think of his dad. Brother Dave's dad was, I don't know, this probably is an exaggeration, but just correct me later. Or don't. Murph, Dave's dad was like 5'6", like 150 pounds. And there were times when he would come to church with a belt buckle that somehow was like right below his chestuses and about halfway down to his knee. And it was just, and I could still see him, and he's walking up, and it's just kind of gleaming in the light, and he's smiling, and he's like, morning. It's a buckle, but it's a buckler. It really hit to the point where it was a defense. God says, I will be your defense that is attached to you. Literally, it's where the term buckle comes from. Belt buckle, where does it come from? It comes from this term buckler, this defense that's wrapped to you and close to you. I want God to be my defense. Amen. I want God to be my buckler that's wrapped to me, that's close to me, that warns me. Something ain't right there. Come on. Yep. That I can talk to people in the church and they're smiling and happy, but they say something, they do something, and I go, something's not right there. Where God defends me as people would attack, as the world would attack, as the devil attacks, as my own flesh attacks me, that God himself would be my defense. Yeah. Reading on. Verse 8. He keepeth the paths of judgment and preserveth the way of his saints. He shows us the path and he shows us the way. And because I saw this when my wife was gone, I will just go ahead and say, this is the way. Okay, that was a joke. Thank you, Brother Ben, for catching it. Brother Ben was a little slow on the uptake, but he was the only one in the room that got the joke, so congratulations to Brother Ben. Where should I go? What should I do? Where should I go? What should I do? Who should I marry? What job should I take? Should I take this class? Should I not take this class? Should I buy this car? Should I not buy this car? Cody now got it. Now he's laughing too. Congratulations, Brother Ben. You are about 25 seconds smarter than Brother Cody. I don't know what that means, but there you go. God says, I'll show you the path and I'll show you the way. You know what I want for these young people? I want God to show them the path. Show them the way. But nobody can do it but you. Verse number 9. Then shalt thou understand righteousness, and judgment and equity, yea, every good path. We're just going to sum verse 9 up this way. God's going to give you a relationship with Him. You're going to understand what righteousness is, what judgment is, what equity is, what every good path is. You're going to understand fairness, right and wrong, what should be done. You're going to understand God's going to give you that. We're done, baptistically speaking. Verse 1. My son, if. I'm going to close my Bible so I can't. Eventually we got to be done because I shut the book. The most obvious application, and stay with me, adults, I promise. Stay with me here, please, if you would. The most obvious application of this text would be this. A parent begging his child to choose personally to have a relationship with Jesus Christ. That would be the simplest, most obvious application of the text. Solomon, at the end of his life, looking back on his life, at all of his choices, his poor choices, his good choices, and he's writing to his kids, probably even his grandkids, and he's saying, no, my son, if thou incline, I beg of you, do this. Choose to have a relationship with Christ. Choose to receive His Word. Choose to memorize His Word. Choose to listen to His Word. Choose to apply His Word. Choose to continue in His Word. Choose to put forth effort in His Word. If you'll choose to do this, if you will, then God will. And I'm telling you, young people, look at me. I'm telling you, Octavian, you'll never regret it. You'll never regret it. Michael, you'll never regret it. But no one can make you but you. No one can choose but you. Just like me eating healthy, it's not going to help Brother Christian. Just like Brother Jay exercising is not going to help me. Your mom and dad believing it, your spouse believing it, your church believing it, is not sufficient to help you. You must choose personally, which means you are personally responsible for the outcome. Well, my parents were hypocrites. You are personally responsible for the outcome. That would be the most obvious application of the text. It's been a few weeks, but if you'll go back to the very beginning of our series in Proverbs, we said this, we'll be tempted along the line to think of this as an old man giving life lessons to young men. That's what an old man does, sitting around on a porch swing talking to his grandkids, and he's like, hey, let me tell you something, son. You know, doesn't cost any more to fill the gas tank up when it's half empty as when it's all the way empty and half full and running out of gas. That's just good life advice. This is recorded in Scripture. This isn't an old man writing to his young kids. This is our Father. Adults in the room, now pay attention, please. This is our Heavenly Father writing to us. You see, it doesn't matter tonight. It doesn't matter if you're 15, 17, or 77. If you're saved, you're His child. Amen. And He as a father would come to you tonight and say, my son, if thou receive my commandments. Yeah. If thou, can't quote it, memorize it, put it in our heart. If thou receive instruction. If you apply your heart, if you seek after, if you. Because no matter how old you are tonight, your dad in heaven, your Father God in heaven has a plan, has a desire, has a path that He wants you to walk. And it's just as significant tonight that you follow that path and that you listen as it is for them. This is very applicable to teenagers. That's the low-hanging fruit. But there is something more here for us. Tonight, we're not worried about leading a horse anywhere. We are concerned that we might be the horse. So a few questions tonight and we're done. And we'll just ask them with no other comment. Are you right in your walk with God? Are you sure? Has there been any growth? And how are your daily decisions? Because this isn't something that they choose that will benefit them. This is something you and I must choose every day. Every day. Every day. And we are personally responsible for the outcome of that choice. You can lead a horse to water, but let's not suppose that we're the leader. What if we're the horse?
Yeah.
Will you drink?
That's good.
Will you drink? Lord, thank you tonight for the real life application, the Monday morning, Tuesday afternoon at work, truths of the Word of God that just soaks in. Lord, tonight, I pray that there'd be a young person that would watch this broadcast, that would hear, Lord, sitting in this auditorium, and they would taste and see that the Lord is good, that they would decide for themselves, Lord, irrespective of what their parents do, their church does, their family lineage or line, they would say, no, I'm going to read the Word of God every day. I'm going to have a prayer life. I'm going to have standards. I'm going to have a relationship with God. I am going to. No, and it's not going to be Calvary and I'm just riding along. It's not going to be Pastor Sutton and I'm riding along. It's not going to be my Christian heritage, though I'm thankful for it. I'm going to blaze my own path. I'm going to have my own relationship. I'm going to make my own choice. Oh, Lord, they'll never regret it. But Lord, to the grandparent in the room, you love them in an even greater way than they love their kids or their grandkids. And you still have a way and a path for them to walk and to follow if we will just submit to you and follow you and choose to have that relationship with you. This isn't just Solomon and his kids. It's you and your kids. Help now, Lord, in this moment of decision. May we be honest and transparent with you. Are we right? Are we sure we're right? Has there been any growth? How's our daily decisions? Thank you for the power that is contained within the Word of God. And I beg that there would be some people here tonight that would say, I'm all in. I'm going to try this out for real. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We stand. The piano plays. The invitation is begun. You can lead a horse to water. Can't make him drink. Your standards or the church's, your God or your spouse's, your passion, or is it just easier to kind of go with the flow? There's a difference. Oh, there's a difference tonight. Wouldn't it be great if God Himself, just like it says in verse 6, God Himself gave you wisdom. God Himself gave you knowledge. God Himself gave you understanding. Where you are constantly, pay attention please, where you are constantly in a state of, oh now I get that. Now I understand. Now I see. Okay, now it connects. where you weren't reliant upon another person's faith or another person's prayer or another person's choice? To the parent in the room, I want my kids to obey. I want my kids to live holy lives. I want my kids to, quote unquote, do right and not do wrong. But I can compel them to do those things while they're in my home. But there's coming a time they will not be in my home. And even while they're in my home, there are many times when they're not in my presence. Success is not conforming to the rule. Success is chapter 2, verses 1 through 5, where they incline, they decide, they personally choose. They have their own standard, their own walk with God. By the way, not their own standard following the standard. It's when everything changes. Everything changes. Amen. As always, if we can help you with anything, please let us know. It's going to be a good week. Looking forward to the week. Wednesday night, we'll be back in our series in the book of Jeremiah, Jeremiah chapter 30, if you want to read ahead, and looking forward to preaching, continuing our series through that. Several things coming up very, very quickly on Saturday of this week, of course, is church-wide visitation at 10 o'clock. Tuesday of this week is the ladies' Bible study. Wednesday night, of course, youth group. Friday night is the youth rally. Saturday is church-wide visitation. Saturday afternoon is the ladies' white Christmas, whatever that is. And then our regular services this next Sunday, with the exception that in the afternoon, right after the morning service, the teenagers will be selling baked goods, primarily to raise funds to go to winter camp. And so avail yourself, bring extra cash, donate some plasma this week, whatever. Don't go to Starbucks. Don't go to Starbucks anyhow, but bring that money to buy stuff from the teenagers, and it'll be a help and a blessing to them. On Saturday after Thanksgiving, which is the 26th, we could use some help helping Brother Smith and Bronner load up their moving truck. And so on Saturday the 26th, if you could help us with that, we'll probably ask again on Wednesday and next Sunday and see who might be available to help on that day at noon on Saturday the 26th, to help load them up. Then on the 27th, Brother Bronner will be with us all day. That will also be Brother Smith's last day with us as our song leader. And so we'll be doing some special things on that day as Brother Bronner's here and playing the piano and singing for us. Looking forward to a great day on the 27th. Brother Christian, anything else we need to make mention of? QR code on the back table. Parents, if your kids are going to camp, scan that QR code and you can register them, sign them up, all of that for camp. If you aren't that inclined, see Brother Christian, and he'll hand the phone to my daughter. She'll show you how to work that and how to do that. And about 30 seconds later, you'll be like, thank you, and you'll walk away mad. You'll be both grateful and angry at the same time. Love you, Calvary. You're dismissed.